Okay, I'm going to start this video off with this picture that we were labeling when the power went off. This is the picture from your textbook that sort of gives you the diagram on how DNA replication is going to occur. This happens during the S phase of interphase. There's a DNA double helix. The first thing that has to happen is we have to unzip the two strands from each other. The enzyme responsible for that is DNA helicase. And so notice that at the end of this enzyme, we have two separate DNA strands and they aren't hydrogen bonded to each other anymore. Stupid joke that I've seen that always makes me chuckle. If I were an enzyme, I would be DNA helicase so I could unzip your genes. That's because that's what that enzyme does. It unzips the two DNA strands from each other. So there's your silly joke of the day. After we've unzipped the two strands, DNA polymerase is going to start the process of making new DNA strand, or what's known as a daughter strand, using the original strand, which is known as the template strand, as an actual template. And so this stays intact, nothing happens to it, and we just use the rules of complementary base pairing to add new nucleotides to this daughter strand that we're in the process of building. Now, because of a quirk in chemistry, each DNA molecule runs in opposite directions, which means one of the strands can be built continuously from start to finish. That's the leading strand. The other strand has to be built in little fragments that are called Okazaki fragments, because we build a little bit and then we get to this and we have to stop and wait for it to unravel some, and then we can build again and then we get to this and we have to stop. And so it just has to work in a different order, essentially. Next up, I kind of talked about this in class, so I'm just going to skip right past that fairly quickly and get to some of the definitions that I had skipped over. So a gene is a recipe for how to make one specific product that the cell needs to make. Usually when I talk about genes, I'm going to say that they code for a protein. They don't all code for proteins though, so that's not necessarily true, it's just that that's how most of them work. And that's why I use that as our example. Out of our 46 chromosomes, each chromosome contains about 1,000 genes, and so we end up with 20,000 genes overall. Each length of chromosome, what that means is there's lots of genes back to back. If you want to use the analogy of a cookbook, so a whole chromosome is a cookbook. Each individual gene or page is for one specific dish that you want to be able to make. DNA is kind of written as a series of three letters, so a set of three letters on DNA is called a triplet. So ACC would be a triplet, AAA would be a triplet. Triplets get transcribed into codons on mRNA. So those same three letters, when we do the complementary base, this isn't called a triplet anymore on RNA, it's called a codon. So UGG is a codon, UUU is a codon. It's called a codon because it codes for a specific amino acid. When we looked up the genetic code and we were using that to figure out which amino acid would be coded for in our activity in class, we have to look up the mRNA codon. You can't look DNA up in the box or the circle. You have to look up the mRNA codons because that's how the box gets written. Now, another one of our quirks is humans have not been around as long as viruses have. And so a lot of the genome for human beings is actually viral information. We don't necessarily want to express that information. So essentially what ends up happening is our recipe book has a lot of recipes for things we don't want to make. And even within one recipe, sometimes there's ingredients for things that we don't want to make. So if this were a gene and we wanted to try to make it, what that would mean is there's the stuff that we actually want that codes for what we need it to code for. Those are called exons or coding regions. Then there's also junk that viruses have kind of tucked in there and it's trying to trick us into making it. Those are called introns. One of the things that happens at the end of transcription is something that's called RNA splicing. During splicing, we cut the introns out of the gene because we don't want to make those, and we just glue the exons together. So exons are coding regions, introns are junk. In reality, the introns probably help us code for multiple different proteins, but we won't necessarily get into that because that's just theoretical. Skipping past the questions. There's three kinds of RNA that we're going to talk about. There's actually way more than this, but these are the three that are going to matter for us. mRNA stands for messenger RNA. It is the usable copy of a recipe of a gene that we make during transcription. So mRNA is usually just one recipe that we can use to go ahead and cook a protein. tRNA stands for transfer RNA. It transfers amino acids to the ribosome in the order that we're supposed to take it. I like to kind of consider tRNA to be the sous chef, because sous chefs help with the cooking, but they aren't the master chef. The master chef is the ribosome. It's what actually makes our protein, but tRNA brings those ingredients to it so it can cook things a little bit better. The final type of RNA is rRNA, which stands for ribosomal RNA, and it's actually part of the ribosome. Ribosomes aren't like your other organelles where there's a membrane around something. The ribosome is literally made out of rRNA and protein, and that's it. So it's part of the chef, if you want to use my analogy again. Okay, the act of transcription is what copies a specific gene into a strand of messenger RNA. This has to happen in the nucleus because that's where our DNA is going to be found. Transcription works a lot like DNA replication, only instead of making DNA into DNA, we go from DNA into RNA. So this is where we use uracil instead of thymine as we are doing the act of transcription. We also only copy one of the strands, unlike DNA replication. In DNA replication, we copy both strands at the same time, but in transcription, we still separate the two strands, but we only make a copy of one strand into messenger RNA. This is the picture from your book that tries to show you how it's going to work. So we have the DNA sequence, or our gene, up here at the top. It gets transcribed into messenger RNA, so we go from triplets to codons. And then the tRNA is what brings the amino acids into the ribosome so that we can make our protein. Those will be bonded together by the ribosome. So when we were doing our activity in class, in the first round of activities, you guys were replicating DNA, so you acted like DNA polymerase, but you also acted like RNA polymerase because you transcribed DNA into RNA. So you did the, you know, T to A, A to U, and then you had made the little arrow saying you were transcribing a strand of DNA. You also acted like the tRNA because you put the amino acids next to the codons by reading the box or the circle that we'll come back to here in just a minute. So this is trying to show you kind of just in picture that's nice and clean how that process works. Translation is the act of cooking. The ribosome carries out the steps, pardon me, of translation. What happens is we read the molecule of mRNA. tRNA works by having anticodons that are going to match up to the codons so that the correct tRNA carrying the correct amino acid comes to the ribosome to bring its ingredient in when it is supposed to. So this is our strand of messenger RNA. We have a codon, GCC. The anticodon on tRNA, which is this green molecule right here, is going to be the complement to the codon here. So again, G to C, C to G, C to G. That's how this amino acid knows it's supposed to bring. I said amino acid. That's how this tRNA knows which amino acid it's supposed to bring. This one has the anticodon that matches this codon, so it brings its correct amino acid. And then the ribosome bonds those together with a peptide bond. Okay. Codon, set of three letters on mRNA. The anticodon is a set of three letters that matches up to the codon. The anticodon is present on tRNA though. So this is mRNA. It has a set of three letters, so that's a codon. This is the anticodon that matches up to that. And this amino acid specifies the amino acid. I said it again. This tRNA specifies the amino acid leucine, which is this LEU up here. So that's how we know which amino acid we're supposed to bring. The anticodon matches up. This is the picture from your book that shows you the overall summary process. So we copy DNA into RNA during the act of transcription. The RNA then leaves the nucleus and it finds a ribosome. The ribosome carries out translation by reading the mRNA and then building a protein by reading that recipe. So this is the genetic code. The box is the one that your book has. Now, the real world situation that's happening here is the tRNA has the anticodon that matches this codon, and that's how it knows which amino acid it's supposed to be. But again, you guys acted like the tRNA, and so you had to be able to read this to know which amino acid you wanted to bring. So if the codon was GCC, you would have to look the codon GCC up here. And so let's see, GCC codes for the amino acid ALA, which is alanine. And so that's how we would know which amino acid to bring in there. Once again, just a reminder, the box is what I would give you in a test because that's what you have in the textbook. Other information, extracellular materials is the stuff that you can find outside of the cells. The tissue that has the most extracellular materials is connective tissue. There's a bunch of proteins, fibers that exist in the extracellular space. Most of the rest of your tissues really just has fluid between the cells, and so that fluid would be called extracellular fluid or sometimes interstitial fluid. Cell differentiation is actually a very interesting concept. So you guys all start out as a zygote, which is a fertilized egg. That's one cell. That one cell can go on to be anything in your body that you need it to be. It can become a bone cell. It can become an epithelial cell. It can become a spleen cell. It can do whatever it wants. So this little depiction right here, imagine that this is a stem cell. As it starts rolling down this hill, it has to choose a path. Each one of these little divots off down here, that's a specific cell fate. Like again, this might be liver, this might be spleen. Once a stem cell has rolled down into a specific trough, it can't then back up and do anything it wants. Like you can't go, oh, well, I just lost a spleen. Let's take a chunk of my liver and try to make it spleen. Once a cell has differentiated, it is in that trough and it can't go anyplace else. Cell differentiation is also sometimes called specialization because a cell picks a specific function and that's its special function for the rest of its life. So this is the process that converts a stem cell into a specific kind of cell, and it happens through gene regulation. Which genes are that cell going to turn on and off? So to get a little bit into more depth about that, this is a red blood cell. This is a white blood cell. The red blood cell and white blood cell, they're both blood cells, but they're different. Red blood cell's function is to transport oxygen around the body. A white blood cell's function is to help with immunity. They do completely different things, and yet both of those cells started out from a stem cell known as a hemocytoblast. What allows a hemocytoblast to become either a red blood cell or a white blood cell is which genes does it turn on. If it turns on the gene for hemoglobin, it's going to become a red blood cell. If it turns on genes that are necessary for phagocytosis, like digestive enzyme genes, it's going to become a white blood cell instead. So this whole process comes about by regulating which genes get activated and which get silenced in a specific cell line. Just a silly joke that I saw ages ago about this. So that process of differentiation is like going to school. You guys are going to school so you can have a specific job later in life. Well, your cells have to do that too. They have to go to school, which is specializing or differentiating, to become their very specific thing they want to be later on. Apoptosis is programmed cell death. It is a natural process that is very necessary for you to be who you're going to be. So these are embryos. I always like to show these pictures side by side because one of these is a chicken, the other one is a human, and it's actually really hard to tell which one is which as you're looking at these two pictures right here because we look very similar in the embryonic stage. We've still got a lot of stem cells present in both of these things, but here's what's really interesting. There's gills present in a human embryo. This is the human, this is the chicken. We also had a tail. We kill that tail, and when we're born, we don't have it anymore. We get rid of the tail through apoptosis. We also had webbing between our fingers. We got rid of that through apoptosis. And so again, this is a totally natural process that is supposed to happen, and it helps us get rid of cells that we don't need anymore. Hyperplasia is kind of the opposite. Where apoptosis is you're killing things, hyperplasia is you're making more of things. If you are carrying out mitosis in a tissue or an organ, you're going to be making more cells, and as a result, that organ is going to get bigger. That's what hyperplasia essentially means. So it's growth of an organ or a tissue by adding more cells to that tissue. What we're looking at here in this picture is a uterus. This is an adult uterus, and you can tell because the myometrium is fairly thick here. This is the muscle layer that makes up the wall of the uterus. In a girl who hasn't undergone puberty yet, those layers are much thinner. They've gotten bigger due to hyperplasia and puberty. Atrophy. This is a decrease in the size of an organ or tissue, usually as a result of disuse. You're not using it anymore. This is a very common side effect, as I say on this slide, of having a cast. If you have a cast on your leg and you're not allowed to bear weight, that means you're not stressing the bone and the muscle anymore, and as a result, it's going to get smaller and weaker over time, which is why a lot of people end up needing physical therapy after they get their cast removed. Okay, telomeres are another one of these weird concepts. Once again, because of a quirk in the chemistry of DNA and the way DNA replication is going to occur, we have a linear molecule of DNA, which means there's an end to it. DNA polymerase can't start replicating DNA on an end. It has to start from a fragment and then build from that fragment. Now, because we have an end that cannot be replicated, because the enzyme can't just start somewhere, it has to start from something. That means the telomeres get shorter and shorter and shorter every time you replicate your DNA. One of the complications of this right here is the last sentence that I'm giving you. One of the things that makes us get old and die is the fact that eventually we get rid of the telomeres and we start leaving off sections of genes, which means there's things that we can't do. There's diseases that we're going to get, all because we had to start hacking off little pieces of our DNA when we started replicating. So telomeres are ends that it's okay to lose, but once we've lost the telomeres, we start cutting off pieces of DNA that we needed every time we end up replicating the DNA. After that, you guys have Latin roots and related clinical terms that you should be able to define fairly easily. The group work, you can once again consider those challenge questions. They're interesting challenge questions. I recommend you kind of look through that to see if you can do it. With that, you should be good to go on the cell chapter.